shot in the head, drowned in despair, disintegrated in an instant, crushed by betrayal, poisoned by power, consumed by darkness, banished to the abyss. Arcane unveils a world where brutality unfolds in unforgettable ways. Today we're looking at Arcane's darkest moments, gruesome to most disturbing. Aside from the obvious spoiler warnings, all I need to point out before we begin is that these moments will be categorized both by how disturbing they are visually and their overall effects on the show, and the audience of course. With that, we'll start with some scenes that were brutal, but not bloody. Powder's breakdown. First, we have to head back to the most soul-crushing episode of the bunch, Season 1, Episode 3. Yeah, needless to say, we aren't starting with the heaviest part of this episode, rather, we're starting with what kickstarted it. When the time comes for Vi and the gang to rescue Vander from Silco's clutches, she makes the hard decision to leave Powder at home, not wanting to risk her in the fight. Poor Powder just wants to be useful, though, for all those colorful contraptions of hers to work properly for once, and you can see all that emotional angst in the breakdown she has. In recent years, well-portrayed mental breakdowns in animation have become a big talking point. Seriously, are y'all okay? And this might be one of the most disturbingly on point of the bunch. To quote a comment from a YouTube re-upload of the clip, the fact that it's so hard to watch is a testament to how well-made it is.
Silco, it's time for your medication!
Open up! It's time for the pill!
Oh, barnacles, I hate this Shimmer. Well, okay, I'm sure he wouldn't say that. Silco is largely responsible for making and distributing Shimmer, so I'm sure he's actually quite fond of it. It's just the installation part of the process he hates. As ruthless as Silco is, even he can't bring himself to inject his own eye with a needle. That's a pain that'd make anyone wince, and one Silco has to go through on a regular basis to keep his infection from spreading. Jace's multiverse tour. Episode 7 of Season 2 was one of the series' highlights, showing what could have happened if things went a little differently that fateful day. Not to mention Echo and Heimerdinger working alongside Powder, yes, actual Powder, to make a time machine that could get Echo home.
Think I might know how to give it a boost.
It's a super sweet plot that occasionally cuts to Jace absolutely going through it in a nightmarish realm full of abstract corpses, which he discovers to be a warning of the world's imminent end via Hextech. Look, I feel for you, Jace, but we all remember that scene from Season 1 where you and Mel banged while Victor was having a seizure and getting cancer.
Perfectly balanced, as all things should be.
A mutual parting of ways. We're jumping all the way to the series finale for this one, and believe it or not, despite a lack of blood, this one features two major character deaths. After a long time of trying, Jace finally manages to get through to Victor and show him just how crazy he's gotten, telling him that his imperfections and everyone else's are part of what makes life beautiful. The result is Victor and Jace choosing to die together to put an end to the Arcane for good.
All I want. He's my partner back.
Setting all of Victor's disciples free in the process. As tragic as it is, there's also a genuinely bitter, sweet aspect to this scene.
There is no prize to perfection. Only an end to pursuit.
Jace and Victor have clashed for the entire season, but at the end of the day, they still genuinely loved each other, and whether it's here or in the Arcane realm, they have a friendship that can't be erased, however imperfect it may be. Farewell, Heimerdinger. Well, I guess that makes two things I didn't expect Heimerdinger to do in this season. Sure, I wasn't exactly betting money on him singing a country song that's actually really good, by the way.
Thank you very much.
But he's also one of the many characters who die in the final act, sacrificing himself to make sure Echo can get back to his timeline. It's less of a bloody, brutal death than more of a phase-out-of-existence death, but a tear-jerking moment nonetheless. We'd place this scene a lot lower if it weren't for the fact that Heimerdinger's species, the Yordle, are actually immortal, which means Heimerdinger's okay! Okay, sources on that actually vary quite a bit, but hush! Heimerdinger's immortal, alright? Heimerdinger's not dead, okay? Heimerdinger's alive, he's fine! And trust me, I'd know, because if they actually killed this national treasure, I'd be feeling much like the moments in this next category, which are pretty violent. Silco's temper tantrum. Every man has his limits. For Silco, one such limit was failing to capture Vi and Caitlin after Huck sold them out. Well, like father, like daughter, because when Silco failed to achieve what he set out to do, he had a straight-up temper tantrum. Well, I mean, there are some differences. For example, Powder wasn't a grown man, nor did she straight-up choke and curb-stomp one of her minions during the breakdown. Like, chill out, Silco, have a Snickers or something. Ambessa's end. Ambessa was one of the most evil characters in Arcane, so most of us weren't exactly tearing up when she was killed by the Black Rose, especially since her death actually served a greater purpose, used by Mel as a means of destroying the Black Rose once and for all.
What are you doing, sister?
Still, evil or not, seeing Ambessa's life force sucked out of her as she shuddered in fear was still pretty creepy, especially given how stoic Ambessa usually is. Street Fighter Jr. You know what else is pretty creepy? A gang of low-life adults beating up four teenagers. Scratch that, three teenagers and one preteen. For the crime of not sharing their spoils with them.
Hear that, Deckard? They don't want any trouble.
You know, in my experience, trouble finds you.
It really goes to show how rough of a place Zaun actually is, especially compared with Topside, and no matter the circumstance, seeing kids get beaten up and chased by a criminal is just unpleasant. Civica versus Vi. There are a lot of amazing fights in Arcane, but some stand out more than others in terms of brutality. Civica's Womano fight with Vi is one of these, as it leads to the loss of a limb for Civica and a soon-to-be indirectly plot-relevant stab for Vi. Add onto that the choreography and bloodiness of the whole spectacle, and you've got one of the most blood-pumping fights in the series, Marcus's fate. Nobody's about to argue that Marcus is a model citizen, but he isn't exactly a supervillain. In fact, he had some pretty decent traits, like genuine care for his men and love for his daughter. That's why, despite all he'd done, we couldn't help but feel sad when he succumbed to injuries from Jinx's explosion on that fateful bridge. Dude couldn't even finish his last words to his daughter. That's a whole new level of cruelty. Kate versus Jinx and Vi. Speaking of cruelty, let's talk about Season 2's Act 1 Kate. I'm not saying she doesn't deserve some sympathy for grieving over her dead mother, especially given all the responsibility that just fell into her lap, but when she and Vi manage to hunt down Jinx, Caitlyn is so tunnel visioned that she's ready to shoot her with a Hextech sniper even though there's a child on top of Jinx trying to protect her. The fact that Kate was ready to risk killing a kid in order to get revenge is already brutal, but then she follows it up by responding to Vi's very reasonable criticism of her actions by ramming her with the butt of her rifle, leading to Vi having a mental breakdown. What makes this even worse is that Kate hit her in the exact place Civica stabbed her during their fight, an injury only she would know about. They really followed up that sweet kiss scene with one of the most brutal emotional betrayals in the whole show, didn't they? Jinx and Vander's End. While this is one of the more ambiguous moments on our list, we couldn't possibly make a list like this without mentioning the final sacrifice of the series. When Vi is desperately trying to pull Jinx and Warwick up to a falling ledge in the finale, Jinx realizes that will only result in a triple death, so in a final act of redemption, she deactivates the gauntlet, forcing Vi to let go and sealing her and Vander's fates.
Always with you, sis.
But not without one last hug on the way down. Some fans have speculated that Jinx managed to survive the fall, but even if she did, the series is over and she's nowhere to be seen, so this was still a pretty gut-wrenching way to end her story. Isha's sacrifice. Closing out this category, we have what might be the most tragic sacrifice in the entire series. After two acts of bonding with Jinx as a friend and basically an adoptive little sis, Isha was forced to make the ultimate sacrifice in episode 6 of season 2. When all hope seems lost against Vander's intensified power and completely deteriorated mind, Isha rushes in to fire a Hextech bullet at point-blank range, ensuring that Warwick is taken down, even if it means sacrificing her life in the process. The implication of a child effectively nuking herself is already tragic, even though we don't see the aftermath on screen, which at least nullifies some of the pain, but the worst part is that Warwick is still able to return later on in the season. Isha's death didn't even destroy Warwick, it just inconvenienced his side of the war. But if you thought that was all bad, well, then you're right. But let's move on to the more visible on-screen stuff. These are the seriously gruesome moments. Maddie's death. Man, this whole scene came out of nowhere, didn't it? What do you mean everyone was already speculating that she was a spy for M'Besa? I thought Maddie was sweet. That is, until her last 2 moments of screen time where she's revealed to be working for M'Besa and has zero hesitation about shooting Caitlyn in the back of the head. Unfortunately for Maddie, the bullet meant for Kate was reflected right back into her own skull, killing her instantly. Poor Maddie died as she lived, by a rebound. Opening scene. On that note, let's rebound back to episode 1. In the opening scene of the show, we see the aftermath of Zaun's attack on Piltover, which resulted in numerous deaths. A young Vi and Powder are seen here witnessing Vander beating an enforcer to death, but worse than that, they bear witness to the corpses of their own parents, leading to one of the most gut-wrenching cold opens I've ever seen. To whomever made the directing decision to not force us to hear little Vi screaming and crying, I just want to offer my sincerest thanks. Vander drowns Silco. Man, looking at Vander before the real-time events of Arcane, you'd have a hard time guessing he was a full-on hero, right? Take Silco's origin story, for instance. Vander saw glimpses of the horrid man Silco would become, and in a fit of rage, he lost control and attempted to drown his old friend. In a metaphorical sense, he succeeded, because the Silco he knew did indeed die that day, replaced by a monster who would only manage to pass his own hatred down to a vulnerable girl. First testing of Shimmer. Poor Tom and Jerry. They were once great celebrities, but they were never the same once the Shimmer epidemic took over their streets. Some say they were so desperate for work that they went to Singed's lab to work as test subjects, and through those tests, they discovered that the drug was so strong it could turn a mouse into something powerful enough to destroy a cat, its natural predator, with ease. I can deal with attempted murder, terrorism, and fascism, but once you hurt the poor kitty cat, that's just too far, man.
Black Rose.
During the end of Season 2's first act, among many other things, the Black Rose begins its assault on the Medarda family. This leads to some serious stress for M'Besa, but one scene is even more brutal. As Mel is dragged into its clutches, she witnesses the possession and death of her friend Alora, after which all we can see is a faint pool of blood.
Rose.
Jeez, this show is not nice to its side characters, is it?
Bye-bye, Sky.
Case in point, Skye. Poor, sweet Skye. She tried so hard to connect with Victor throughout her time on the series, so...
You know, there's always tomorrow, right?
Good night, Miss Young.
When Victor went overboard with his work on the Hex Corps, she was quick to rush in and help. Tragically for her, this would result in an instantaneous death, her body being turned to dust, much to the horror of both Victor and the audience. Skye was literally just a girl with a crush who wanted to protect Victor, and she straight up disintegrated for it. The only reason we aren't placing this even lower is the fact that Skye at least lived on in the Arcane for a while, keeping Victor company. There have been worse fates, just not many as shocking and heartbreaking as this one. Caitlin versus Ambessa. Black Rose isn't the only one gunning for Ambessa, though. In the finale, Kate squares up for a one-on-one fight with Ambessa, though not without some help from Mel's newly discovered magic.
You remember. Shut up and fight!
The reason we chose to include this fight over so many others is its climax. When Ambessa manages to target one of Caitlyn's eyes with her blade, Mel is only able to hold back most of the sword, and unlike Silco's shimmer injections, Kate's eye was in some much clearer danger here. That feeling of dread before the inevitable loss of an eye is just one of many intense scenes this show has thrown at us. Grayson and Benzo's deaths. Oh, but trust me, the bloodbath gets much more brutal. Grayson and Benzo were just two of Silco's many victims thanks to the completion of shimmer. After Deckard was thoroughly roided up beyond recognition, he tore Benzo and Grayson apart like they were nothing, leaving behind puddles of blood and absolute horror in Marcus, who up until now was portrayed as a pretty black and white bad guy.
What the hell have you done? This wasn't the deal!
Echo's grief for his boss and basically father figure only makes it even sadder, especially given how overjoyed he was to see him again in the series' final act. Oh, what could have been? Rictus's interrogation. Characters being stabbed by warlords and ripped to shreds by monsters is disturbing, but it's always going to take a backseat to more realistic stuff. We all know there are some bad cops out there, so Rictus's violent nature is particularly hard to watch. He'll incite violence over anyone he suspects as hiding information on Jinx, and is more than happy to beat others nearly to death, after falsely imprisoning them, mind you, to get the info he needs.
You have Jinx to thank for this. She is not your friend. She is not your champion.
There's doing what you need to protect your people, and then there's being the very thing your people need to be protected from. Judging by how cruel Rictus is with his victims, we don't have to clarify which of those camps he falls under, right? We've seen blood, war, panic, psychopathy, and all other kinds of horror, but even so, there are still five more scenes that we think deserve extra attention. These are the genuinely disturbing moments. Jinx's attack and aftermath. Really, this entry is more of an umbrella entry for the whole of season one's finale, The Monster You Created. This has to be one of the most intense TV episodes we've ever seen. The whole thing revolves around Jinx having kidnapped Vi and Kate, forcing the former to choose between Caitlyn and herself.
No!
Sheesh, I'm not that crazy.
Basically, it's the decision of identity for Jinx. Will she be accepted back by her sister or be abandoned as Jinx forever?
Are we still sisters?
Well, the heart-pounding tension of the episode results in some serious tragedy. Not only does she shoot Silco out of sheer panic and instinct to protect Vi, leading to one of the saddest death scenes for a character who, frankly, absolutely deserved to die, but she follows this up by cementing her own identity as a monster by firing a rocket at the Counselor's Tower, which kickstarts the events of Season 2. Some characters were killed instantaneously in the rubble, like Caitlyn's mother and Counselor Bulbuck. Others were changed forever after the experience. Particularly, Victor was injured so severely that Jace had to hook him up to their unstable technology to save him, which turned him into the corrupt savior he remains for the bulk of the season. Then there's Salo, whose legs were crushed and who was resultantly turned into a paraplegic and whose screams I won't be able to unhear for a good while. All in all, it's a seriously brutal sequence, and those of us with anxiety might want to make a cup of tea to keep calm in the process. Rio. Oh boy, animal lovers, proceed with caution. It makes all the sense in the world that the mad scientist Singe is introduced alongside his death-defying experiment on Rio. Like, just look at this cute little axolotl dude. He's so adorable, they even made him into a marketable plushie. Isn't he precious? You can buy yours today. It's the perfect product to help you get over whatever in the unholy hell Singe did to this poor creature.
She's dying. I'm attempting to prevent that.
Like, jeez, man, I get wanting to cure death, but wait, no, I don't. If the only way to live is to live in constant agony, unable to actually enjoy life or do anything, what's the point even? Warwick. Well, in some cases, I guess the point is to become a super weapon. Enter Warwick, aka Vander, the sequel. As many fans theorize, Singe kept Vander's body chained up in an effort to reanimate his corpse into a gigantic monster known as Warwick, a creature with almost no recollection of his humanity and driven almost entirely by pure animal instincts.
Louder.
Warwick is absolutely terrifying. Like, remember that dude, Rictus, the police brutality guy? Warwick made him look like a drunken ragdoll. Once he's flooded with too much power to control himself, he starts crying what looks like straight up lava, a clear indication that Vander is not having a great time right now. When Jinx kills him to save Vi's life, the calm tears flowing from his face almost seem like they're saying thank you. And judging by how long it took Singed to get all this man's organs in order, I can hardly blame him.
Kill me! I'm in constant pain!
Our runner-up spot goes to what might be the most shocking death in the series. It's not one of a major character, nor one that even has too much impact on the story. Rather, it's just the death of Rennie's son. In other words, a minor character who's related to a slightly less minor character. Any way to slice it, the death of a kid is going to be tragic, but with Isha, the difference is that we didn't see her die on screen. I'm not saying it was exactly ambiguous, but at least we didn't have to see the whole brunt of the tragedy. With this kid, his death was a tragic accident caused by the fact that he was the son of a woman who was in league with Silco, and worst of all, right when Jace was willing to attack the Shimmer distribution facility head-on, he just accidentally murders a child. It's one of the most brutal and stomach-churning moments in the entire show, especially given how much it clearly shakes Jace. The fateful attack. But with an episode like The Base Violence Necessary for Change, there's not much that can top it in terms of sheer brutality. Ironically, we're closing out this video with a scene from the same episode that opened it.
I can help them.
After Powder's breakdown, she rushes after Vi and the gang to help rescue Vander using her little monkey grenades, having underestimated her newfound secret weapon, though she accomplishes more than she bargained for. When the group was close to saving the day, the explosion resulted in 3 deaths. Vander, who died cushioning Vi's fall from the crumbling building, and Milo and Clagger, both of whom were killed mostly off-screen via crushing, skewering, and a whole lot of blood. This is all followed up by a celebration from Powder, who genuinely thought she helped, but found out the hard way through Vi's harsh words that she caused the deaths of their whole family.
I only wanted to help. I only wanted to help. I only wanted to help my own.
I told you to stay away.
Please, please.
I told you to stay away.
Watching Powder get left behind and subsequently taken in by Silco is, without a doubt, the most harrowing scene of the entire show. No matter how you feel about Jinx as a character, you can't deny that at one point, she was just a little girl who wanted to be helped to her family. And that overzealous dream led to her destroying exactly what she wanted to protect. It's bitter, it's brutal, it's downright nauseating, and it's without a doubt the most gruesome moment in all of Arcane.